Merlin Bird ID is by far my favorite birding app, and in this video I'm going to show you exactly how I use it and how you can too to find and identify more birds. If you already have this app, then go ahead and skip to the timestamp right up here, but if you don't, stay right here because I'm going to show you everything related to setting up the app and getting started. So the first thing you're going to need to do is log in to your eBird account. This syncs with eBird, so then all of your life lists and stuff is updated. And if you don't have an account, just go to eBird.org and it's really easy to create one. Once you're assigned in everything, you're going to need to get a bird pack. Now there's a lot of different bird packs on here depending on what part of the world you live in. I have installed on here the US and Canada, so this is going to include all of the birds commonly found in the United States and Canada, as well as a couple of rarities. Now if you don't have enough space to install this pack, you could go with some smaller packs, such as the Midwestern pack or the Pacific Northwest. In my case, I could get Texas and Oklahoma. But if you want to get all the birds commonly found in the US, then just go ahead and install that, and I've already got it installed on here. And you can delete a pack at any time if you want to. As far as other things go on settings that you need to know, if you want scientific names to be shown, you can check that box. Also, if you have a different language that you want the names to show up in. On Sound ID, there's a couple settings you can go there, and then you can either save your settings using Merlin or eBird. I have it on eBird, although I just use the eBird mobile app to log all my sightings. Next up is the Identify tab, and on here you're going to find Sound ID, Step-by-Step ID, Photo ID, and then your sound recordings from Sound ID. So to start with Sound ID, you click on it, listen to birds, and then as it finds birds, it's going to show them, and as it identifies birds, they're going to pop up on here. However, it's not always accurate, so you do need to have a basic understanding of the bird's songs. You can stop the recording and then play those bird songs to make sure that it correctly identified it, but I found that about 90% of the time, it is correct in its identifications. Next up is Step-by-Step ID, and I don't use this a whole lot, but what you can do is you put in your location, what day you saw it, and then the size, any colors that were seen on the bird, where it was, and then it's going to generate a whole list of birds that could potentially be seen for that area based on what you put into it. I don't use this a whole lot anymore, but I used to quite a bit back when I was learning how to identify birds. It's a great tool, especially if you're traveling to a new area and stuff, so I highly recommend you get familiar with it and know how to use it in case you do end up needing it. Next up is Photo ID, and I really like this quite a bit. So how it works is you put in a photo, and then it lets you zoom in a little bit to get a better look at it, putting in the location and date that you saw it, and then it's going to give you a list of birds that look like it, and it does a great job with this. However, if you have birds that look very similar, like in the case of long-billed and short-billed dowitchers, it's not going to be able to tell the difference. You're going to have, but it is great for narrowing down a lot of species very quickly. And then the last tab here is the My Sound Recordings, and this is just recordings that you made while you're using Sound ID. You can delete these at any time, but if you heard like a rare bird or something and you wanted to save it, this is a great way to do it. And you can import recordings, but I found that this just doesn't really work that well. However, if you recorded a bird with a microphone or something, then you're able to import it into Merlin Bird ID, and then hopefully it will identify it, but I've never gotten that to work very well. And then next up is the Explore tab, and this is my favorite part of the app. Now, in the Explore tab, you can go to bird packs, and then if you have different packs, you can switch between those, or you can just hit show all installed birds, and then it's going to show all the birds in your pack here. And on the right, you can see there is a bar of birds. So if I want to go to shorebirds, I'm going to click on that. If I want to go to hawks, I'll click on the hawk. And that's just a quick way to quickly get through a bunch of birds to the birds that you want to go see. So this is kind of like an online field guide, and it works pretty well. You can also type in birds up here. So if I wanted to see a ruby-throated hummingbird, I could just type in ruby, and then it comes up. And you can also do four-letter abbreviations in here. So if I wanted to see an evening grosbeak, I could just do E-V-G-R, and it's going to pop up. Or if I want to do like a lark sparrow, L-A-S-P. And then it shows up. So that's a very quick way to sort through birds if you know what bird you're looking for. The other part of the Explore tab that I like is likely birds. So you can put in a location, and then it's going to give you a whole list of birds that you could potentially see at that location and date. You can also do year-round, so if you just want to get a year-round look at all the birds. And then you can see here, it tells you how likely a bird is throughout the entire year. We've got the months down there. So like blue-winged teals here in the Rio Grande Valley are mostly winter, fall, and spring birds, and then they head up north for the summer, and you can see that pretty clearly down there. Common yellowthroats, though, are here pretty much year-round, although they do become a little less abundant and harder to see in the summer. So as you can see, that is a great tool for finding where birds are at and what time of year, especially when you're going to new locations. That's also a great way to become familiar with the birds of your local area. And on here, you can also sort by most likely to get the most likely birds in this area, or by family. And if we do family most likely, it's going to put them in family order, but then most likely birds are going to be on top of that. So as you can see, the red dot means rarer, the yellow dot means uncommon, and then if there is no dot, then that means that they're most common. And that little check mark there means it is on my life list, and then we can actually sort by birds that are not on my life list, and it's only going to pop up birds that are not on my life list. We can do most likely, so I can see the most likely bird that is not on my life list for the Rio Grande Valley is the Audubon's Oriole. So next up here in Merlin is the Life List tab, and this is a list of all the birds that you've seen. It plugs right into eBird, so when you submit a bird on eBird, it's going to show up in here. So as you can see, that is a list of all the birds that I've seen. We can also search if I want to see Tufted Titmouse. I could see it right there, see its map and all that stuff. And then it has the number of birds seen on my life list at the very top. You can also sort by families if you want to do that. You can see them that way. It's pretty cool to see what all is on your life list. Now there's another tool that I really like to use when it comes to researching specific hotspots or looking for specific birds in specific areas, and that is eBird. And I have found many birds that I just wouldn't get to see if it was not for eBird, so click or tap on this video right here for my complete beginner tutorial. It's also linked in the video description below.